So without further ado, thank you so much for being here, Joachim.
Thank you.
This is Joachim Garraud, everybody.
thank you.
Let's give him a round of applause. Right? So flew in up from LA.
Yep.
You're here for a quick turnaround, and we're able to kind of come in and make this happen with us. So again, thank you. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
And that's my pleasure.
I'll give you the floor, my friend.
Okay. So welcome, everybody. So we're gonna spend almost 2 hours together. What's my job actually, from DJ to producer, and what kind of evolution I had in that, in my story. And then after, we're gonna go deeper into the production tools. I'm suppose there is a lot. We're on the room who's working with Ableton. I'm right. Who's working producing music or with you? Okay, more or less everybody. Okay, okay, good. And then the second hours, we're gonna go deeper to some example of track by track with different style of music, and I'm gonna give you the more I can give in 2 hours, you know. So first, before doing any introduction, I have a short movie just to explain what I'm doing.
Welcome to the lab.
Okay, so as you can see, I have, let's say, three different jobs. The first one is DJ, artist on stage. The second one is producing music for myself when I'm producing music, and this is the music I play during the night when I'm on stage. And the third hat is producing for other people, make music and compose also music. I was lucky to have a classical music education. I was learning piano and drums in France when I was six, and then this classical music education was pretty good to introduce myself to the music and to have the basic thing, learn how to learn. It's always good to know the alphabet if you want to learn a book, and in the music this is more or less the same. And today it's not necessary. You don't necessarily have to go through this classical music education to learn how to make music, because you have in front of you a computer and keyboard, and we have now different techniques to produce music. But sometimes having this kind of past helped me a lot to introduce myself and to talk with people in the same level in terms of music. For example, last year I was lucky to produce music for Beyonce and Jay-Z. That was, I believe, because I have this good skill in terms of DJ, but also because I was able to go behind the piano and to find the right chords easily and follow somebody can sing the song, which is, I think, a good thing to learn. it's not necessary today because there is so many good things to do with computer, and now there is a lot of people don't have any knowledge in the music can produce amazing music, and this is good. So I'm gonna play just some frame like this, some image pics. When I started that job 25 years ago, the DJ was the worst job in the nightclub era, because there is the money was very bad, very cheap. You have to understand that the guy behind the bar was making 10 times more money than any DJ, and the guy who's controlling the door, he was much more successful with girls, and he was also the richest guy from the nightclub. But when I started that job, that was the only job I want to do, because that was exactly the perfect situation for me to share the music with other people. And I was in the basement with no light on me, nobody knows my name, and nobody took care about who is the DJ. They just want to have good music. But 25 years ago, I was very happy to do that job, and I'm still happy to do that job, even if today the situation completely changed, because since 25 years, let's say that job with the electronic music is completely changed the world. And I was lucky to be part of that evolution. But let's say when I'm on stage, and this year I was lucky to play at Lollapalooza in Chicago, in front of 65,000 people. And so when you are when you're in front of so many people, you have so many good vibes. But I have to be honest, the passion is the same than 25 years ago when I was in front of my 12 friends playing the music I was producing during the day, and that was for free. And just want to tell you that even if today everybody wants to be a DJ, because if you stop a young guy in the street, say, hey, what job do you want to do? I'm pretty sure in the top five, you're gonna have DJ. And if you ask to those people, tell me why you want to be a DJ. Oh, yeah, I want to be a DJ because I want to travel in a private jet. And okay, and next, oh yeah, I want to go to the 5-star hotel. Okay, man, but you just have to know that be a DJ and trying to live with the music is not that kind of direction. So just focus on the basic thing is having pleasure to make music, having pleasure to share the music with the other, and keep the passion number one. Because if you're just trying to do that job just to be famous, I think you have some risk. You're gonna be disappointed. This year, in 2015, I was excited to produce my own festival in Paris, outdoor festival, electronic music festival. The name is Inox Park. And I asked to Steven Gelo to come to play the final part. So he said yes, he came to Paris and he played in front of 25,000 people, and that was a very good night. And then he just told me a good story. He said, Joachim, do you remember 10 years ago when we have all celebrating your birthday in 2005? And I said, yes, I remember. Yeah, the evolution is amazing. And I will show you a very short movie. The name is Private Party. And this is in 2005. And you will see how the business changed in 10 years.
Ça fait du bon, là.
So this is the first time for the Swedish Mafia outside Sweden.
Yeah. Yes. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I can be your father, so respect. All right?
Dans un petit instant, si je vous dis qu'ils sont tous déjà autour de moi en studio. Joachim Garraud, DJ résident superstar d'FG, entouré, une fois n'est pas coutume, des plus grandes stars de la house, David Guetta, Steve Angelo, Sébastien Ingrosso et Axwell. Ils sont tous là. Ah bah ouais, Eric Prydz, excusez-moi, je regardais ma fiche. Et puis on se retrouve dans un tout petit instant. Bon anniversaire à toi, Joachim.
Merci. Bon anniversaire, Joachim.
Yeah. Merci. Go.
Truth. Space invaders are back.
I'm good. I'm just enjoying the party. You know, it's an amazing lineup tonight. I think we would have filled up any nightclub in the world with this lineup. It's amazing to be here, man. I do everything for Joachim. You know, it's a good friend of ours. It rocks.
Happy birthday for you in Swedish. This is how we do it Swedish time. Vem säger hip hip hurra?
Jag säger det sen, men vi kör först.
Okej. Jag må leva, jag må leva, jag må leva ut i hundrade år.
Jag vi ska leva,
jag vi ska leva, jag vi ska leva ut i hundrade år.
Ett fyrfärdigt leve för Joachim Garraud. Han lever. Hip hip
hurra! 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 Hurra!
So that was a good party, you know. As you can imagine, especially because that was in front of 100 people, maybe 120, and I was for free, and I was only people I invite to come the last minute and say, hey, what are you doing tonight? I'm celebrating my birthday. The guy came. A lot of people, they didn't realize since 6 years after, say, hey, remember that night we had that people on board in the same room that us. So just to tell you that in 10 years, the evolution is huge today, because even if I want to do the same thing today, I will not be able to do it. I can say that because I tried to do it. And it was impossible to do it, because for booking Eric Prydz, you have to go through an agent, going through a manager, through going a booking agency, going, say, what the hell? If I want to talk to that guy, and I'm chatting, say, Eric, let's do it again. Yes, for sure, man, let's do it. But then, nothing. So just imagine, it's hard to do that with one, but now doing with 10 people like this in the same day, it's pretty nightmare to do that. Now, just to tell you that the thing, that the evolution is a good evolution in terms of business, in terms of popularity for everybody. It's good also because in USA, they're doing so much money for all the festival, and you can see all these big event like EDC, like a Coachella, all those events at the beginning, or let's say 5 years ago, there was only one weekend. Now they're doing 2 weekends back to back, and they're selling a lot of tickets. And this is great because it means that the music business changed a little bit. 5 years ago, I was making 80% of my incomes by selling records and 20% by doing live. And today, this is completely the other side. I'm doing 80% of my incomes by making live and 20% by royalties and selling records. Because nobody buying music anymore, let's say. Actually, we have the chance to go step by step into the streaming process, which is a good thing, I believe. But you can't compare that what was the music sale 10 years ago. Anyway, so today everybody wants to be a DJ, everybody wants to produce his own music, selling his own music through a beatport internet. So the competition is hard. So that's why a lot of people are here, you know, they're searching how I can increase my chance to do music every day and to have a lucky life just enjoying music every day and making enough money just for me and also for my family. So a lot of people want to be professional and they go through this kind of school who's learning and give you the right thing, I believe, to have more success in the music industry. And actually, there is, let's say, two different ways to increase your popularity and make the difference between the other when you have the kind of profile I have, let's say musician, producer, and DJ artist. The first solution is to try to produce the biggest show ever. Let focus everything into the production. You can say, okay, I want to produce a show with, 2,000 square foot of LED wall behind me. And you can produce something crazy just to make the difference between the guy who's playing before you or the group gonna play after you. So this is one solution. Some people have chosen that solution to put every money they can have from the music into the production to increase the popularity in terms of production. And then the other solution could be also to have your own track played on the radio, because that's the best way to promote your name. Actually, in USA, the people who's earning, who have more money back from the music business are the people who have tracks played on the radio. So if you look at the charts, for example, you have Avicii, you have Calvin Harris, you have David Guetta, all those people, they have tracks on the radio. So they're gonna be able to ask for a better fee, which is normal because normally the name is bankable more than somebody completely unknown. So you have this different option, and I want you to focus first on the second option. Say how we can produce music and produce your own sound. 20 years ago, that was very hard to have your own sound because all the process of producing music and writing music and composing music was very hard. It was impossible for one guy only to do his own music because you have to ask to a sound engineer to book a recording studio, to have a musician, to have somebody gonna work on the arrangement. And at that time, a team was necessary to produce a track. Today, as you understood, with your laptop, you can do everything by yourself. So, because you have all access to computer and software, and especially in that school, I'm gonna start to show you something. Basically, what I recommend, it's first working on remix. Remix is the easiest way to introduce yourself into the music business because there is a lot of conquest every month you're going to be able to find some conquest about people do a remix and put your name close to big stars who's always looking for fresh blood. It's great and easy because you just have to download some parts. Sometimes you just have to keep the a cappella. And then you're working to produce the music around the vocals. So let me show you just an example. So that was last year when I was lucky to work for Beyonce. We did this one, the Drunk in Love. And I'm going to show you this session. So in terms of music production, I start in 1987. That was with Atari. ST and my first software was the Pro 24, and that was 24 MIDI channel, not audio. That was only MIDI channel, and then I moved to Logic, Imagic, and no Notator. First it was Notator, and then the Macintosh came on board, so we were able to have audio. So I moved to Logic, and then I was the first to have Pro Tools in France. I was the first one. I came to California to bought my Pro Tools, and I brought my Pro Tools back to Paris, and I was the only one to have that thing. And the first Pro Tools version I have was 1.6, and there was only 8 tracks mono, 16 bits, and it was crashing nonstop. But that was, for me, that was a revolution, because they, wow. Imagine you can move that thing from there to there. You don't have to cut splice with the tape. It was pretty cool. So, and then I stay from Pro Tools from 1992 to 2006, and I was lucky to work with the team in California to develop some plugins, some shortcuts from version 4 to 7. I was really involved in the development. I was sending page and page of reports. Say, hey, this sucks. This one, you have to do that. And then I say, guy, Joachim, we can't do everything. You have, right, okay. And then Digi Design in 2007, I believe, or 2008, because they were so powerful, they decide to introduce again the hardware. And they introduced the first mixer, first Avid mixer hardware. And then from that day, they stopped to be number one, because again, they were linked to a hardware. And when you're doing a hardware, you can't imagine how long the process is to move one button from here to here. You have to go through prototype. It's amazing. When you are only on software, switching two buttons, maybe 2 days. So when they start to introduce again the hardware, they lost some people like me, because I was asking for a lot of different upgrade. I say, hey, can you do that? Can you do that? And sorry, Joachim, we can't now, because we can't move that thing, because we have the hardware linked. All right, guys. And now if I want to travel, because I'm DJ, I'm traveling around the world, I can't bring my hardware interface and my rack with me, especially in the plane. Other guys say, Digi Design say, no way, nobody gonna produce on the laptop. Believe me, they're gonna stay in the studio. They need the studio. Hey guys, I'm not sure. That was in 2007. And then Live Ableton, they took the two guys from Logic and two guys from Cubase. And the number one target of Live Ableton say, we're gonna focus on only laptop. We don't care about studio. We're gonna produce the best, not the best, but we're gonna produce the software can be used on laptop only for all those people traveling like me. So that was good, because I say, okay, guys, I'm gonna come on board with you. So we start to discuss, and then Ableton. So now I'm staying on Ableton. I quit definitely at Digi Design last year. Every time I need to access to a Pro Tools, I always have a friend around me who have a box, and ask him, okay, can you just load that session and give me the stem, please? And that's it. Anyway, so now you have also Logic, and you have QBS, you have Fruity Loops, you have different software. This is not a question of software now. I believe it's the creativity behind that. What I like in the Ableton Live, it's very flexible. I am going to be able to produce one small jingle for an advertising, like 15 seconds, to a complete movie, and I will show you later, a complete movie, 2 hours long with strings everywhere, and you can do that also on Live Ableton, which is great to have this kind of thing, and especially because the best thing for me, this is my studio, my recording studio. This is the real recording studio I'm using for all the project I'm doing since 5 years. It's MacBook Pro, and for sure I have a room in LA and one in Paris because I need good speakers. That's the only thing. But let me show you something. I bring also my speakers. So that's my speakers, my ear monitors. So let's say laptop and ear monitors, you have a full studio, mobile, you're nomad. You can produce on the train, in the plane. And so that's a real revolution today, because it means that people gonna make the music of the future tomorrow, or are the people able to work with the laptop? And for sure, it's good to learn and to know how to record somebody, use microphone, speakers, compressor. But let's say 80% of the job could be now done in the laptop. Okay, stop speaking. Let's go to the... Sorry for my bad English. If there's something you don't understand, feel free to raise your hand, okay? Okay, so do you have any question about what I said in this first 30 minutes? Or can I go in the live session now?
I have one question.
One question.
Hardware with your laptop for input, a little mini keyboard, a push, what do you like?
I like two things. The first one is the small keyboard, just to play, because not very easy with the key of the computer. So I'm using the CME, so the CME X key. That's the keyboard I've included in my producer box, the steel one, black. And the other thing is, I'm using a very good interface. I'm very close to Universal Audio, so UAD is still my favorite. So I have, let's say in each studio I'm working, I always have my UAD over there, so I just coming, plug my computer. For sure, I'm not using the output of my laptop to produce music, just today. Okay, so when I had the vocal from Beyonce in pink over there, so let me play you that thing. Is it this one? So
I know. I've been drinking. I get filthy when that liquor get it to me. I've been thinking. Why can't I keep my fingers off it, baby? I want you, nah nah. Why can't I keep my fingers off it?
So on the vocal, that was pretty basic. I just use this delay tape I really love, the J37, adding Jack Joseph for the vocal, and then just ultra maximizer. I don't have a lot of work to do on the vocal, because when you're working with those stars, they give you one stereo stem and everything is perfect, because you have 10 guys like me working only on the vocals. Not tens, let's say three maybe. But normally when you have the vocal, you don't have anything to do, it should be perfect. So I just try to make the vocal a little bit more dirty in terms of sound, because that was a little bit too clean for me, but that was my idea. Then, so when I get the vocal, first, they came to me and they asked me, okay, Joachim, can you produce a house techno track, 127 BPM or 130 BPM? And I tried with the vocal, but the vocal was 80. So I tried, and that sucks. So the my next meeting was with the crew to play my version 127 BPM. And I said to those people, and I was very honest, I said, you know, guys, it's not gonna do it. I can't do that 127. It's very bad. And I play the small test I made, and it was very shit. So I say, guys, I can propose you something different because I start something else. So I knew that the 127 is not gonna work, and was the tempo difference was too high, too big. The gap was too big. So I start to produce a cool remix that's like 80 BPM, a little bit faster than the vocal, because the vocal was 70. So 80 BPM, and I start the production normally with the drum, because I was lucky to have learning the percussion at school, and I'm still very close to the rhythmic thing. And I believe when you have a good beat, you have 50% of the track. And when you have a good beat and a good bass, you have 80% of the track. So so let's say, so I start the beat, and for doing the beat, that was pretty easy. I decide to do something very, very minimal, because also the rule number one when you're producing is less is more, and especially in electronic music, especially right now, because this is unlimited layers. So you can add, you can have three different bass drum and having five snare drum, which is stupid today. And I think it's better to have one bass drum and one snare drum, but finding the right sound. So rule number one is less is more, and especially in the production. So I start with a low bass drum. You can see in blue over there, and this low bass drum is the kick from Nicky Romero with a long length, you know. So to have the note a little bit out of tune, I'm starting at 49 hertz and going to 45 to have this kind of glide, whoa, 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 like this. You don't have to stay straight, you have to go a little bit down like this. And then I had another bass drum to have the impulsion and to keep the longest note coming like that. And then I had so that's a part of the groove, and then the clap over there. So with these four tracks, let's say you have the spirit of the song already, because it can give you the groove. Then I have some percussion in purple. Okay, and that's it. That's it for the rhythm, because I love when you're doing production to produce with instrument, and all the instrument gonna be part of the rhythmic. And this is also one of the highest recommendation I can give tonight, is you need to think about leaving space for everybody. So think about the song when it's gonna be done, it's gonna be all together. So if you feel you have some drop and some gap and some space just by listening the drum, this is perfect, because those space gonna be used by the bass, and small the other space gonna be used by the keyboard. So that's what I'm doing. So I had some cello over there just to have the note. The cello are in brown over there. So that's from Contact. Okay. Some piano, FM. Okay, and then so the gimmick number one is from flute, in this is MIDI over there, and this is played by the Lush 101 from D16, and this is in audio over there. So you can see over there that I'm leaving the space into the gimmick da 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 answer, and that's the way when you're writing music is to think about answer between everybody, and when you have a very good syncop with a lot of syncop track, you're gonna be able to have a very rich, because everybody playing in his own place and. The puzzle is done by pieces with all this kind of instrument. If I'm playing now the global thing without the voice, I'm giving you the voice, okay? You have, so that's a part of the verse. Okay, I'm going. The voice, you have that. So. It's just to show you that I think if you want to start by something, you have to start by remix, because it's gonna give you the opportunity to have your name push in some big project. And also, it's great because when you have already the melody like that, you're free to just play around and to give the best of you, your best input, your feeling. And the good thing is today, if you're listening to different remixes, you're gonna have so many different personality on each remixes, from somebody gonna do a dubstep version or somebody gonna do a house version. You have so many different vibes. So remix is good for that. Okay, so I'm gonna go to show you now deeper in one song. I'm gonna talk more around the plugin environment into Ableton now. So I'm gonna use my own album. So I'm taking the other hat, you know, my own album. So this is the new album gonna be released with Ultra in USA January 22nd. And then I'm gonna take a track I made with only some distortion, because I really love this. What I like also is to play with the sound design, and the good thing is all those plugins now, they are very cool, and you are very you can very create amazing sound, especially if you working with a reactor or this kind of plugin. It's you can really have your own sound, which is, I think, very important today. Because if you're listening to some track on the radio and you can recognize, oh, this is Nexus preset, and they use the Vengeance bass drum. Okay, they took only the preset. And there is too much songs actually played on the radio sound exactly the same, because everybody using the same drop, the same Vengeance bank, the same preset from the bass. And when because I have my own radio show, I receive maybe 120 new track per week for people just send me this just to be playing the radio show. To be honest, on the 120, I have maybe 80 sound exactly same. So I have an automatic answer, say, okay guys, it sound exactly same. Can you try to just work first on your sound, doing your own library, doing your own sound, working more on the design, and then you're gonna be able to submit your song, because it's gonna sounds different than every 79 song I received this week. So that's why I recommend when you're doing production is to spend time into sound design and to have your own library. For this new album, my new album, the name is 9624, 96 kilohertz, 24 bits. I spent 3 months to just work on having some setup, basic setup of drum sound, bass sound. And during 3 months, and I didn't produce any song. I would just listen to sample, making my own. Oh, I like this bass sound, but maybe I can add some delay on the top and compressor and phaser. Okay, sounds good, so save that thing. So for 3 months, I was preparing all the color. And then after, when all the color was ready, I was ready to paint. And that was pretty good, because when you're producing an album and you're using the same colors, you have a pretty homogeneous, you can say that in English? Homogeneous album with all different tracks as close from the same family, but different. So this track, the name is a French name, is Passage en Force. Passage en Force means when you have the, for example, the police close the road and you decide to go. And so you go through. Passage en Force means let's go. But you know, you don't know the issue. Maybe it's gonna be the last track for you. why I choose that name? Because this is a very aggressive track, really dark, and using a lot of distortion. And the lead sound, is done by the Fat Filter Saturn. And so I'm gonna play you the track from the top. So the lead sound is this one. So look at all the parameters over there. You can see this is very hard to control, and because I was expecting to make some notes with only distortion, but distortion is normally a noise. But I was very excited to find the right way to adjust every noise to go from one note to another note. And so that's why if you're looking at this part of the window, you have all this red point, means that you have all this parameters with automation everywhere. You have the distortion, you have the frequency, the dynamic thing. And if you take away this plugin, if I mute this plugin, so I'm listening solo. See, if I mute the solo, I don't have any distortion at all, but I don't have any note. It's always the same. Pom, 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 pom. Then, if I'm had the distortion, I have all this note here. So that's why I have so many automation on this one. That's the same process for this one. You see the feedback. And the drive. And no effect at all. So if we're listening this part, distortion and no distortion at all, 3, 4. Only the beep. So this is really hard to control. So for doing that, I'm connecting a small mixer. I have a small mixer from Allen & Heath with 4 channels. And this is, maybe 24 parameters, knobs. And I'm just making my first selection of what kind of parameters I want to change, and then I can stay maybe 3 hours on a very small loops to find the right move, recording, and then when it's recorded, okay, save, next part. But at the end, you have something unique, and I know this kind of track is not going to be played on Kiss FM radio for sure, but I don't care. I like that sound, so it's my number one rule. So making music, it's very ego process. It's making music for myself first, and then if you like it, good. If you don't like it, I like it. So this kind of techno track, so there is no vocal for sure. But you have a good energy, and you don't have so many track, so many stems. You have a kick drum and yeah, it's like you're making some automation on the reverb, small, big. You know. So now I want to show you something different, and I think it's really important in terms of production. I was starting to talk about syncope when you're starting to make a song, and. This is really something I've learned from listening original master tape session from Stevie Wonder. And one day I was lucky to have my friend who had a copy of the tape, the 24 tracks, I believe, from one track. I don't remember which track was from Stevie Wonder, but that was a track from Stevie Wonder, I remember. And he was playing for me track by track. So, hey, listen to that. So we're listening and it's a doot, 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 doot. He said, what, are you sure that's in the song? Yeah, are you sure? Let's listen to this one. Doot, 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 doot. I said, no, hey, you're joking, that's not Stevie Wonder. Yeah, wait. And then listen these three things together. Ta-da, doom, bam, bam, bam. Ta-da-tum, bam, bam. Oh yeah, all right, understood now. And then all the session were like that, was pushing one note over there, one note, and then take the syncope like that. And for sure, when you were listening track by track, it was completely not musical. It was not very logic, because you can't hear the click, you don't have the beat, so you don't know where's the one. But when you have all those tracks together, it makes so groovy music, because everybody's playing together, but leave space for everybody, which is, I think, one of the rules. So I've decided to try to use this kind of rule for my own track. And so I made a track. The name is DJ Play That Beat. This track was, I was for this kind of syncope. Leave space to everybody and just making some few notes from sound, very close in the term of family, and when you're listening all those songs together, you can you identify all the sound as one, only one synth. But okay, let me show you that. So for example, the term, okay, so Simon term over there in the yellow, let me move my slider over there. So you have over there the yellow, you have the boom, boom. So it's easy because you understand the movement. Then I'm gonna go over there to show you the answer. So I have only the yellow. Now I'm gonna listen the green, this one. So that's the same thing. Now if you're listening the yellow and the green, you have really the grooved balance, with two different things. And then I just add small two notes of bass, like the TB3 or 3 over there in that section. Huh? So if you're listening only these two notes, it's very small. but he makes the links between the two notes on the top. So if you're listening to these three sections together, he makes the groove, and then you just need to add a clap on the top to keep the... And you're good, you're good to go. And you have only four stems. And then a kick and bass drum. And you have a pretty much a groove. So just to also add a groovy bass over there, because that was also in the same process of adding a different layer. So that was this layers, boom, 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 tantan, and it's working well with the tom over there. So I have three layers. If you listen that, you can feel that there is maybe one or two different instruments. But at the end, there is a lot of different instruments making only one. And this is what I recommend when you're starting to produce music. It depends of kind of music you are producing, because if you want to have only radio hit to travel in a private jet, I'm not recommend to start with this. But if you want to have fun to make music, you have to do that. But that's a joke for people who were there at the beginning. So let me play you just the beginning of the song.
Can you hear the sound?
So only four stems. Number five is the crash. The crash. Clap. And then in the white, you have the vocal coming. The bass.
Can you hear the sound? Can you feel the heat? Did you bring that back? Did you play that beat? Can you hear the sound? Can you feel the heat? Did you bring that back? Did you play that beat?
Same voice, but pitch down, 12 down. And then a small break down with the serum over there. And then we're going back in the groove with the cobalt. So this is very basic, very dub music. But I was surprised, because a lot of DJs really love that kind of shit. I was playing my track because it makes people dancing. And when you are also a DJ, you're looking for this kind of track, not too much aggressive, not EDM style, and could be play. And so that was one of track from just to make some experience between syncope and playing with different sound can make one sound together. Do you have any question before I'm going on to something different? Yes.
In the track before, I noticed you...
The distortion one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or the one you put on before this one.
This one. Just this one before this one? Or?
Well, it's like the one where like all your sound design and all your music tracks, you had them all in one group. I was just curious as to why you did that.
Sorry, I didn't understand. Again. Repeat.
Yeah.
Why I'm doing this? Good question. Because I'm using group at the end to work on the compression, because most of the time I need to separate music. Music is everything except the rhythm, bass drum, and vocal, if there is vocal. Because all these four families need to work together, and in terms of compression and sidechain, they all have to work differently. And for example, in the previous track, I had a group called Music, and in the music there was only the synth, but you have also a group called Drums, and you have the, the bass drum outside of the group, just to be able to not be compressed with the sidechain, you know. So I'm doing group, and the group are the most of the time used for different sidechain setup.